you. Ian, I have to say, I've really enjoyed your talk. I was waiting my whole life for someone to tie every disease and every single thing to spinal fluid and the spinal fluid to come out. You just made my day, okay? If I only had this to say, but I have to give a little talk here. Thank you. So, alrighty, well, that is advances here. Good. So, I'm going to talk about spinal fluid disorders, of course. I'd like to say at the beginning that I got permission from the Art League Rhode Island to show some of the art pieces that were displayed through the on the previous symposia that will help, you know, to pass on my message of my today's talk. So it wasn't until the first CSF symposium in 2016 that I found out how much of an artist my husband Thomas is. I told Thomas, listen, we need a logo for that conference. And then he was going into his computer and he said, here, you got your logo. And I said, Thomas, I'm not quite sure that. He said, well, you got your ventricles, you have hydrocephalus, you have like some, you know, like the obstruction of the skull base that's provided by the Chiari malformation. And then he said, and then I'm going to trickle you down into the spinal canal, and you have like the water dripping into the spinal cord, which is the syringomyelia. And then further down, there's a big unknown, something is pulling on our spinal cord, which is a little tail, that's a leftover thing from our embryo times, which is a great unknown, I'll show you. And so that's why he stopped that cartoon there. So, as I said at the beginning, CSF disorders are probably a poster child for a lot of unknowns and threats that we're dealing with, where only other folks can help us. And I think here the artists, designers, and engineers, and engineering scientists are on the spot. I said, you know, patient, the engaging patient, and the compassionate surgeon know that they're in this together, but they cannot function alone. We have congenital conditions with unclear pathology and origin. Even the doctor doesn't know, you know, how that all started and why now things act up at your later stage in life. We have a prospect of a very delicate surgical intervention for something we quite don't know a lot about it. So certainly, needless to say, that there's a lot of controversy and also a lot of opinions about surgical intervention and approaches. And so in my ambitious talk, I just wanted to pinpoint, you know, what is the unknowns, what is the threat, and how can the artists help to understand that and to visualize that. So let's start with hydrocephalus. Certainly, that is what we teach the medical student, and what Ian just said, hydrocephalus is seen in an MRI with the ventricles swollen. It can affect like elderly people. They all of a sudden, you know, start to have symptoms of like cognitive decline. They cannot walk right. They start to shuffle. They cannot control like holding their urine. So then the surgeon comes and drains it out, as Ian has well illustrated, with a ventriculoperitoneal shunt, and hopefully, eventually, things get better. So certainly, things do get better, but never ever appreciate this. Can the surgeon or the doctor appreciate the threat that the person fears? And I have a little video, a patient that Dr. Salloway and I treated in Butler Hospital.
Okay, come on back.
To just give you an example, and then we'll talk about the threat.
And what did it feel like when you were walking?
A little more difficult than it had been my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
More than a little.
Okay. And you've had some falls?
A few, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And what's the next thing you noticed? Trouble with controlling your bladder?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And what was the problem with that? Once you get the urge to go, you gotta get there.
Quick.
Uh-huh, okay. And then some trouble with your memory. You said keeping track of recent conversations. It's short-term memory.
Right, not long-term.
Keeping track of schedules and details, that kind of thing.
Right.
Uh-huh, okay. And how about your interest in doing things? Did that change at all? Motivation for doing stuff?
difficulty wants to do things, he just can't.
Uh-huh.
Well, here we go.
Okay, come on back. Okay, how does your walking feel?
Good.
Yeah, what's different about it?
Well, I can walk.
Yeah.
That's a biggie.
Okay.
But it feels good. The balance is...
Okay, come on back.
I want to stop here, and I don't know how to stop that. Hold on. I can walk. So the one thing what is really the biggest threat for these folks is the fall. And some people never get better. And that was always hard for me to understand as a young resident in neurosurgery. Why do they not get better? I'm telling them, see, listen, your walking looks better. But they say, I'm afraid of falling. I just don't want to walk. And even though they feel better, they are still afraid of falling because they never have forgotten how it was when they once fell. So when we had our first symposium, remind you that condition is called the Hakim's Triad. Victoria Garina, who's one of the Rhode Island Art League artists and sitting here, she had a picture which she named the Hakim Triad. And I said, oh, that got me interested. So she's probably going to draw some ventricles and it's going to look a little artistic, but she did this. And I went to see this picture, and in an instant, in a heartbeat, as a physician treating these patients, I knew what she was showing. She was showing that horrible fall, you drop to the floor, and I understood now, and no one could more beautifully show, you know, the threat of the patients. And that is what I want to show now my medical students that I teach about hydrocephalus. That's what you are up to if you have hydrocephalus. And you're going to be better in order to identify that condition and fight for improvement and for better care and management. So here is how the artist can help me face the threat. And I just want to show that I purchased it because I want to have it always with me to remind me what I have to do. Thank you, Victoria. Also very controversial is the syringomyelia. So syringomyelia is often very subtle and very minute problem in the spinal canal. Because it's hard to see, then it doesn't exist, at least in the conventional medical world. And many of you know that. So this was basically signed off as a normal MRI. You see the spinal cord here. You see spinal fluid around the spinal cord. And this girl was having progressive leg weakness, back pain, falling spells. And she was signed up for a psychiatric consult. A radiologist, I have to say, in our department, Dr. Raw, kind of picked up on that, and he found like there was some black signal in the spinal where the spinal fluid should move, and then he got us a little bit of a higher dedicated picture where you could see like little letters, something, you know, maybe also kind of in terms of medical illustration, you can think of kind of making that a little bit more visual. Where there was like a little something where here it's more black, here it's more white. And that was concerning for stagnant of spinal fluid flow. So eventually we diagnosed her with some obstruction, some scar at her spinal cord, and she needed surgery for that. And we went in, and we found that webbing here that was plastered to her spinal cord, and after that webbing was resected, she had normal flow, as you can see here in the MRI, and all her pain and symptoms in her legs went away. So syringomyelia is very subtle, often not seen, and has a very insidious progression, hardly noticeable, until it is such a threat because people cannot really express how they are feeling, that people are signed off for something else, but probably treatment or even surgery that can help. And here, again, getting back to Victoria, for this year's kind of symposium, she actually dedicated her picture to syringomyelia. And I thought, again, nothing better than that picture can describe my patient. That's how she walked into my office. with not knowing what's wrong with her. So the face of a threat can supported by an artist and much better than a physician can ever explain to the patient, but also to the medical students when teaching. Chiari malformation, we can talk, of course, we can talk a whole day, or not even a day is enough to talk about Chiari malformation, Dorothy. But I want to just bring up that there's another threat here. Certainly, one threat is the headaches. I want to educate you real briefly about what Chiari malformation is. It is a malformation where the part of the cerebellum is dislocated into the spinal canal that is also congenital. It can sometimes also be acquired. But what it basically does, it takes away from us a spinal fluid kind of area that we need to equilibrate the spinal fluid pulsation between our cranium and our spine. That is certainly a dynamic process, and if the cerebellum is taking that space, like sitting there like a cork in a bottle, then our fluid pulsations are not equilibrized, and that causes a lot of headache. And this is a very difficult process to describe. You already see me struggling to describe it, and I always find different words every time I speak to a patient, and sometimes I fail in expressing what this really is, and then people don't believe me. But anyways, so here, for example, here for the computer scientists and for people that model diseases, I brought that up for Victor Onshia and Carl Sousa, who are speaking later, that we have to talk about, you know, how we can maybe model the flow, and people do that, and Dorothy is also supporting that research. But that is something where we cannot do enough for that, okay? But it's not all only about flow, it's also about deformity. And if I put deformity in an artist's mind, I can already see what's working and how we can show that deformity. But what I want to say is that we don't know why that deformity causes more problem than just headaches. When Hans Chiari and Professor Arnold found that first, I hate to say, in deceased people, they saw this deformity of the lower part of the cerebellum kind of stuck in the spinal canal. But there's a there's a big variation amongst like how the deformity looks in every individual. Chiari can occur across the lifespan. You have a little one here, 3 years old, where kind of the deformity is like almost like a peg. Like structure. Then sometimes we call them the tonsils, the lower parts of the cerebellum. Sometimes they are just huge, large, and that's why they're obstructing. And sometimes they have like a little white dot on the tip, which probably is a scar that is kind of showing that there was some compression. People just say, okay, it's a deformity. But what people have not appreciated is that this deformity can mean something and can certainly affect not only like the pain disorder, but can also affect cerebral function. Because a lot of people with Chiari, they complain about a brain fog, loss of concentration and memory, and we actually donated or dedicated a CSF conference 2 years ago to Chiari and cognitive failure. And here again, I want to make the link that artists back then had been able to show what the threat of Chiari can be for a person. That is what we see as surgeons. We go in there, we divide the tonsils, we sew in a little patch because we want to give extra room so that the spinal fluid can circulate again and equilibrize the pulsations between the cranium and the spine. But what we don't see and what we don't appreciate is this. That's the patient. We'll fix it, but we not always fix the patient. And here there are some pioneers that, just to confront you a little bit with the research that's been doing, also supported by the Chiari and Seringo Mailia and Bobby Jones Foundation, is that there are certainly, you know, the cerebellum is not just an organ that controls our balance and our fine motor. The cerebellum has multiple circuits to very vulnerable parts in the brain and is certainly involved in emotion, cognition, and we have to appreciate that. So we're not only treating like a dynamic disorder, we are really treating a brain disorder here. And Schmarmann, a neurologist and a professor of neurology at MGH, was the pioneer of the cerebellar cognitive affective syndrome and came up with the dysmetria of thoughts hypothesis, where you are not only having that dysmetria, but you're also having dysmetria of your thinking. And that can be devastating and certainly, you know, can break you. And here is a picture that I don't even know what the name of the picture was of that art piece, but I think it really nicely shows, you know, that could be a dysmetria of something, you know, that should be looking the same, that should work together, but doesn't. And this was Sarah, who presented on the symposium her decline in school grades with her Chiari. I need 3 more minutes. This is the face of the threat by the artist, where I think the confusion is very well depicted here by a face just disintegrating. Certainly the tether cord is very important. I'll make it quick. I'd like to appreciate Kendall Lane, who's a young medical illustrator and also a designer in art, who made that picture for my website, drawing me that little tail where Thomas, my husband, stopped making his cartoon. And so she finished his work. Thank you, Kendall. She's over there. And we're doing a lot of research about the tethered cord. And you cannot believe, you know, people don't believe that this little thingy, which is at the base of our spine, can do a lot of harm to a person. And it's not always seen on the MRI, as with a lot of cerebrospinal fluid things. That's why I think medical illustration is very important here. I cannot say it enough. But my before last slide is just showing the research that we are doing on that tail. We're trying to understand why do we have it, and what does it do if it's not working right well. We are thinking that this little tail might be important to steady our spine, to give signals to our paraspinous muscles in order to make us stand still or sit still. But it could be that if the phylum is not normal, this little tail, it sends nonsense signals to the body, and that's why people kind of hunch over or, you know, have an abnormal posture. And we are advancing that research. I have to go back because I really want to appreciate my research collaborators, Abby McElroy, who is a doctor in veterinarian medicine here in the audience, and our Department of Neuropathology, and the Veterinarian Medical School at Tufts, Annie Uriarte, and Michigan, Anne Rushmere. Annie Uriarte is also here in the audience, and we are looking at different species that suffer from that bad story of the tail to advance the research. Again, an artist that has drawn this, it's called kind of Ebola, and I think, you know, if you have tethered cord, Ebola is going on in your body. And again, this shows the confusion that we have around that disease. And Professor Tarlov, a neurosurgeon from the last century, who was a Jewish-Russian immigrant, also started to try to draw the tail in a very minute way and single out every cell. But again, here, you know, certainly illustration and arts go together. And this again shows the threat. This is my own art. That is me getting too excited about CSF disorders, and then my ventricles swell up. Thank you, everyone.